morning, all the dear participants. Myself, Dr. Iresh Bhavi. So here I'll be dealing with some of the traditional teaching techniques and modern teaching techniques, and what are the advantages and limitations of both the techniques. So here, this is the faculty development program organized by Sri Sangan Baswa Mahaswamiji Polytechnic. Continue with my presentation. So this is the structure of my presentation. Here in the beginning, I will be discussing what are the traditional roles of a teacher and what are the modern role of a teacher, how traditional role and modern role are completely differing, and what are the challenges we come across in traditional roles and how we will tackle those challenges in modern teaching techniques. And then I'll be discussing some of the modern teaching techniques which will help us to capture the attention of the students in the classroom teaching. So there may be other methods also, so which the methods which are very much which I have identified as very much useful and which have helped me to capture the attention of the students. Only those techniques I'll be discussing. There may be other techniques also which you might have developed by yourself, and so that you will be using those techniques even more efficiently than whatever techniques I have discussed here. Then I'll be dealing with some of the Google Classroom features which will be used to interact with the students after the classroom learning. Then I will discuss about how to make videos for YouTube channels. So let us first discuss about traditional versus modern role of a teacher. Traditionally, the role of a teacher has been as a provider of information. So here the teacher is provider of resources and information and all the notes to the students. The teacher was believed to be the fount of all the knowledge. So here the traditional technique, it is believed that teacher is having a very great knowledge in that subject, and only teacher can teach, and the students will be listening and will be observing the concepts taught by the teacher. But actually what happens, this is a completely a teacher-centric approach. Here teacher will be superior and he will go on delivering the lectures, and you can see the classrooms in which the row of the benches will be there, in which the students, all the students will be sitting, and they will be listening calmly to the what teacher is teaching on the blackboard with a chalk and board method. And whatever the teacher delivers, the students will be just listening to them, and they may be sometimes physically present in that class, but mentally they may not be present in the class. If the teacher is lucky enough, the students will take down their own notes. Otherwise, the teacher is expected to dictate the notes also to the student in the traditional teaching technique, or it is a teacher-centric approach. Whereas in a modern role of a teacher or modern teaching techniques, the teacher is a facilitator, a person who assists students to learn for themselves. Means what? Now the role of the teacher has completely changed from a resource provider to a facilitator. So teacher will be facilitating the students to learn by themselves. Here the students will themselves will decide in which manner they want to learn or how they want to learn, whereas the teacher will be only facilitating the students to learn. Here all the students will be at different stages in their learning, and in consequence here what happens, it is individualization of the learning will be there in a modern role of a teacher. Here all the students will not be at a same level. That is, some students may be learning chapter 1, other student may be learning chapter 2, and the student may be learning any other thing or any experiment. Here all the students will be at their own level and at their own pace they will be learning the things. Here learning has been individualized to suit the individual requirements and abilities of the students. Some students may be fast learners, some students may be slow learners. So fast learners may pick up the pace and they themselves may learn too much, and they may go to complete first, second and third chapters. But whereas slow learners may be still in the chapter one itself. So they themselves will be deciding with what pace they want to continue their learning. Whereas the teacher will be only facilitating them with all the resources, or sometimes the student themselves will collect the resource if any doubt is there in the minds of the students, that the teacher will be going to solve those doubts and will be helping the students in their learning activity. So why this change has occurred from traditional role to a modern role of a teacher? There are so many number of influencing factors which has influenced us, or which has force, which is forcing us to implement the modern roles of a teacher. Those are, it is recognized that adults, unlike small children, have a wealth of experience and are able to plan their learning quite efficiently. So here, whenever we are teaching to a college students, the college students are not small kids, they are adults now, and they have plenty of knowledge and experience. They have plenty of experiences how to learn themselves. So they can decide themselves how they want to learn, and they can plan their own learning activity. So the modern role of a teacher has come into existence. And not, we know that all individuals cannot learn in the same manner or at the same pace. So that if a teacher talks to a student, some percentage of students might get benefited, but some students, few of the students may not get benefited, because their teaching level, their learning levels are different, their learning pace is different. So due to that, all individuals cannot learn in the same manner. Everyone learns at their own pace and not of necessity at the pace set by the teacher. Here, teacher will not be deciding with what pace or with what speed the he has to complete the syllabus or teach the subjects. The student himself will decide whether he is a fast learner or he is a slow learner, how much time he want to spend on each topic. Those all will be decided by the student itself. Only the teacher will be facilitating the student in his learning activities. Hence, the individualization of the learning has its own advantages, defined advantages. Now let us discuss what are the classroom challenges we face in a conventional teaching method. The biggest challenge for any teacher is capturing each student's attention and conveying ideas effectively enough to create a lasting impression. When we are delivering the classes in a conventional classroom, here the student may be physically present in the class, but whereas mentally the student may not be present in the class. Mentally he may be thinking of some other things or any other outside matter, but physically he will be silent, hearing to the teacher. So due to that, what happens? Student may not catch all the concepts which the teacher is teaching on the blackboard. Hence, conveying ideas effectively is not possible in a conventional classroom teaching. Hence, in order to grab the attention of the student or capture the attention of each student, or to tackle this challenge effectively, we should implement innovative ideas in teaching, which will make our the classroom experience much more lovable for our students. So the student should love to attend our classes and should concentrate even for up to 1 hour also, or more than 1 hour. But actually what happens when we are going for a traditional teaching techniques, student cannot concentrate for more than 20 minutes. It is the capacity of each and every human being. So maximum they can concentrate up to 20 minutes, or if he is very good in concentration, he may concentrate maximum up to 30 or 40 minutes. Here are some innovative ideas that will help you reinvent your teaching methods and make your classroom more interesting. So there may be other methods also, but these are the methods which I have identified, which can help you in tackling the challenge of capturing the students' attention in the classroom. They are, first one is audio and visual tool. With the help of audio and visual tool, that is by incorporating audio and visual materials or some simulations or some animations in the classroom, we can able to teach the students more effectively. The student can learn all the concepts or working models or how the machine will work or device will perform. Those all can be visualized with the help of audio and video tools. Hence, the student can learn the things or concepts in the better way. These can be the models, maybe any working models or film strips, or they may be your animations, or they may be some movies, pictures, or any infographic or other mind mapping techniques or brain mapping techniques, which can be used as audio and video tools for capturing the student attention and making the students understand all the working concepts. Such tools will help their imagination thrive and grow. These methods will be used to will make the students to listen to all the lectures and help them to understand the concept better in the classroom. Then we can go for real world learning. In the real world learning, we can give so many real life examples to the students while they are learning. We can create the model of the working model of the actual machines or actual devices, so that by seeing those working model, by observing those working model, they will come to know how the actual machine or device will perform or work. And we can give some real life examples which can help them to imagine, which can help them to improve their imagination power, and which can help them to understand the concepts in more better way. And it will keep them active completely in the class. Here, relating and demonstrating through real life situations will make the material easy to understand and easy to learn. Take the help of tools to stimulate creativity. So we can use so many tools which are available, maybe video tool, audio tools, or any working models which may be available in the market, which can be used. Or we can insist the students to develop their own working model so that they will understand the working more in the more better way. Include the forms of working models to demonstrate and capture the young minds, interest of the young minds. Then brainstorming. So in during the classroom session, so we should keep some brainstorming sessions in the classroom, like imposing some questions or quiz to the students, or imposing any problem which has to be solved by all the students. So by using these brainstorming techniques, when we pose any problem to the students, there may be so many brains, multiple brains focusing on a single problem or single idea. Then definitely we will get numerous ideas and will also involve everyone into the discussion. So each and every student will give their own solution for that given problem, so that we'll have so many multiple number of solutions for the same problem. Due to that, what happens, we'll be getting multiple solutions, in that we can select which one is the best one. So a creativity can be improved in this case. And here the student will never bother about whether it is right or wrong. Just the student, it is a good platform to for the students to voice to their thoughts, to give voice to their thoughts. Hence, student will never worry about whether the whatever the solution he is giving to the problem is right or wrong. We people have to give proper suggestions when a student is whether right or wrong, and then so that they can come up with their own ideas or solution techniques for the problem. Then we always have to welcome new ideas. Means we should be always open-minded. We should have an open-minded attitude, because whenever our management or principal or any higher authorities or HODs, they impose some teaching techniques or any new methodologies or any new techniques, then we will always be resisting that one. We will always be resisting that changes. It is a common nature. Though we claim it as we are open-minded, it's a human nature to resist the change. But we should be open-minded to welcome all their ideas so that even if he may be a higher authority or he may be a student or even he may be a lower authority who is lower than us, but we should appreciate their ideas, we should appreciate their new methods which they have evolved, and we should welcome them, and we should make try out those new ideas in the classroom and make our teaching more impressive. Then the flipped classroom method. This flipped classroom is the very popular method of teaching. Here in the flipped classroom, what happens? Here you can see that this line indicates that below the line, whatever the activities the student is doing outside the classroom, this above line is the whatever the students that does the activities in the classroom. So here, before coming to the class, it starts from here. Before coming to the class, what they will do? The teacher will be giving some topic to the students, and the student themselves will prepare. All the students themselves will prepare before coming to the class. They will read it, they will understand it, and they will collect the resource materials from the library or from any other website or anywhere, and they themselves will try to learn. And then once they will participate in all, they prepare themselves, they will be ready to participate in the classroom activity. And when they will come to classroom, during the class, what happens? The teachers will facilitate the student for their learning, and teacher will be clearing the doubts if they have any doubts, and suppose any additional extra material or resource is needed, that the teacher will indicate where those resources are available, or he himself may provide those resources for the student to acquire more knowledge. Hence, in the classroom, the student will practice applying the key concepts, and even the student may give the feedback on what they have learnt before class. Then later, after the class, the student will go back home, and they will check themselves and they will evaluate themselves. It's a self-evaluation, whether they have understood it properly or not, and they will extend their learning. So this is the flipped classroom methodology. In the flipped classroom methodology, you can see here that students are made active participants of the learning process by passing the onus of learning on them itself. Means we are passing the responsibility of learning on the students itself, so that the teacher will relegate to the role of resource provider. Means teacher will step down from the role of resource provider. Teacher will not be providing any resources or notes to the students. The student themselves will collect the notes and information and concepts from the library or from the website or from any other means. Then they will be gathering those concepts and information, and they will do the self-study before coming to the class. Using various tools and techniques, the students are encouraged to construct knowledge and fill in the information gaps and make inferences by their own as and when needed. This is a very popular method, flipped classroom. You can try this method also in your classes. Then arranging quizzes and games for the students. So here what happens, when we continuously go on delivering the lectures and all those things, even the students gets bored, they may not have proper attention in the classrooms. So what we can do is, in between we can arrange some quizzes, puzzles and games, so that their learning activity will be fun. So learning is fun when puzzles and games are part of education. Definitely the student will learn more, and also it will be learning to face the challenges. So puzzles, quizzes and games help students to think creatively and face challenges. Then simulating classroom environment. This is very important. Actually, what happens if the classroom is very neat and tidy and clean and is well decorated and having a very pleasant look, then definitely it will stimulate the minds of the student and also of the teacher. So teacher will have very good, teacher will be loving to go to that class if it is very neat and very good looking, and even student will also love to enter that class. Hence the classroom environment that is well decorated and having pleasant look will help stimulate a student's mind. So this has to be kept in mind. So even this applies to so if any principal sir is there or any HOD sir, they can think over this one, and they can, and even staffs can give proposals or suggestions to their HODs and principals to make the classroom look good. Then work together as a team. This is very important. When we complete our class and go back to our staff room, then we have to spend some quality time with our colleagues. So here with our colleagues, we have to discuss how our class happened today, and what are the challenges we faced, and how can we tackle those challenges, and what are the new teaching methodologies, what they are trying or what they are doing. Those all can be shared with each other so that we can come up, some of them may come up with their very improved teaching methods. We can see many of them come up with interesting strategies, and those interesting strategies can be used or implemented in our own teaching methodology so that the teaching can become very interesting. Teaching and learning can become very interesting. So collaborative work is always yielding. Hence, we can collaborate with our colleagues, we can have healthy discussions and spend some quality time with our colleagues, and we will share our own ideas and let them share their ideas, and we both will come up with very good teaching techniques. So collaborate and introduce innovative teaching methods. Think about a new hobby. Here, after all, we are human beings. So sometimes what happens, a work, hectic workload may affect our engagement in teaching. So we have to do so many documentation, that NBA documentation, so many accreditation boards documentations will be there. And along with that, so many other departmental works will be there. Along with that, we are required to carry out our teaching and learning process. So while teaching, after our class, definitely we people get exhausted and tired, because we are also, after all, human beings. So what we have to do is we have to develop new hobbies like listening to music or painting or drawing, so that whenever we feel that we are exhausted or we are tired, so we can try out these. We can take a short break and engage ourselves in some other activities like listening to music, like indoor games, or like painting or drawing with a short break. Don't stretch it too much, just for a short break, maybe for 10, 15 minutes or 20 minutes, we can have a short break and we can refresh ourselves and we can refresh our mind, so that we'll be again ready for the next work. This will rejuvenate and we'll be ready to work with more passion and more interest. Lastly, I can tell that love what you do and do what you love. So this is what I can say is, if you love what you do, then definitely you will do what you love. So always you love your job, you love your duty, but always we have to strive hard. Definitely we have to work hard for development of our organization, because whenever we develop professionally or personally, definitely our organization will also develop. And whenever our organization develops, definitely those benefits will be always we will be getting directly by development in our professional and personal life. So this is about the traditional and modern teaching techniques and some of the teaching techniques which can be used to capture the attention of the students in classroom learning. Now we'll be discussing about Google Classroom and how to use that Google Classroom to communicate with our students or classes, and how can we share the notices or assignments or materials and videos to our students by using this Google Classroom technique in our next session. Thank you. Thank you very much.